Hey everyone, my name is Nigel Cole, Olympian, super heavyweight boxer for Trinidad and Tobago, and this is The Face of Boxing.
Evening Trinidad and Tobago, welcome to another edition of Scoreboard here on ACT, and it's always a pleasure every Tuesday evening where we come into your home and we talk sports. Tonight we're going to be continuing our series in boxing, actually paying tribute to the tremendous effort and performance of the Trinidad and Tobago national team that recently came back from the IBA World Championships in Serbia, where Nigel Ball became the first Caribbean boxer to earn a bronze medal. The other members of the team, they did very well, and we are not going to let that go unnoticed. And tonight we have one of the members of the team together with two of the coaches. And let me first introduce to you Coach Ralston Dopwell. Coach, it's a pleasure.
A pleasure to be here.
Right, and we have the boxer that goes by many names, Anthony Sean Joseph, Sean Joseph, Sean Anthony Joseph. Whichever name you know him by, that is the boxer across there. Sean, I will call you Sean. Sean, it's a pleasure. And again, congratulations on a brilliant effort. And viewers, at the end of this program, we're going to replay that entire fight with Sean. And you judge for yourself if he wasn't victorious in that bout. Coach, a lot of criticism. You all have weathered the storm. There are a lot of people who have criticized you all, the program, and everything about the program. But what has happened here recently is silence all the critics, because you're not hearing nothing from them. But that is behind the bridge. This championship here that recently concluded, give me your whole view, your thoughts, and everything concerning it.
Well, first of all, George, it's like Bamali say, so much things to say, and people say things.
Yeah.
Right? But what motivates me most of all is when I get criticized. Right? I use the negative and make it positive. Right? What I must say most of all is that this team is a well-bonded team put together. Right? I and Mr. Cox have been working over the years, and we have a mutual understanding of each other. Whatever I do, he don't interfere with. Whatever he do, I don't interfere. We bond, we mix and match whatever we have to do, and make it positive for the youngsters that we in charge of. This, what took place in Serbia here, is work that in progress.
Yeah.
Right? This is not all that we working on. We really looking for our Olympic medal. Right? But it's half stepping stone. Right? And this is one of the stepping stones. 2019 was our first move where in a world championship that Trinidad and Tobago had a boxer that win fight in 2019, where we had Michael Alexander winning two fights, and we had Nigel Paul win one. Right? So from there, the work started hyping. We started to see fruits bearing, and we continue to work in that leg to elevate the youth that we work with. And Trinidad will see a lot more, because we're not taking on what people say. What people say motivates us.
I'll get back to you. Let me talk a bit to Sean. Sean, well, I have seen you from, I think, from day one. Because remember, we were always involved in boxing. You know, I saw you from the beginning. But for the viewer's sake, how did you get involved in the sport of boxing?
Well, I used to be lining on the streets. You know, and after I finished school, lining on the streets, right here with my partner, lining, smoking, drinking, going home late in the night. And I started lining on your bridge, you know, you're sweating on the court. You understand? But I did, you see, going boxing. So, all right, I come over with him.
And who was that?
Huh?
Who was that person?
Marcus Charles is in here.
Okay.
Sam, but we not get again now. We know how the life is.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? But we went in the gym. I see Dash. I see some other boxers saying no. But when I see the boxing, right, Dash say, will you come to? I say, I come to watch the boxing. He say, you could go down and train one time. And I have my rubber slippers, I have capris, and a vest. I take off my rubber slippers, and I start to run around the gym now. Community center.
Yeah.
Right by the community center, by the clinic, and the boys' school and the girls' school right opposite each other.
Yeah, I think I have an idea.
And I started tune, and from that day, I never stopped tuning.
So you never regret that, eh?
I never regret that, eh?
No, I know that to get to the championships that you went to this year, there had to be some challenges that, you know, tell us, you know, what kept you, you know?
Well, you will, when you're doing good, it always have people who don't want to see you do good.
Mm.
Always try to bring you down. But for me, that is my strength. You understand? I have my own motivation, my own strength. And then I go have the coaches to talk to you when they see you doing shippiness. When they see you straying away from where you're supposed to be doing, they will talk to you. And then they go have other people who helping you and supporting you the same way as the coaches. Right? And them go talk to you too. You understand?
Go to the World Championship. What was that feeling like?
Right? That was a real good feeling. I could have got suspended from the national team. You understand? And boy, I wasn't going to take that. I sent by million voice note to the coach. I need to make back the national team. That was in 2020. Before the lockdown, they couldn't fly outside. Right? And the coach tell me the only way to make back the national team, I didn't make 52 kgs. I say, yeah, coach, man, I'm making 52 kgs. I'm hungry, fat, I'm thirsty. I'm making 52 kgs. You know, 1 week before we leave, I was 53.3 kgs. They tell me we had to stop training to close off the borders. The same day they close off the borders, we were supposed to go Argentina for the Olympic qualifiers. And that really hurt me because I can only dare in training to make that week. Because it's about 18 to 20 pounds at a loss to make the weight. That is how hard it is in boxing. And that the kind of sacrifices that I make just to make the weight. You understand? And just to train. You understand?
The experience now in Serbia, your first World Championship.
Right.
Tell me, like, you know, how it was for you when you reach and know that there's a big stage for you, you know. How the adrenaline was, how, you know?
You see, when I now walk in the gym, it had a gym in Serbia where all the boxers from the tournament was training in. Right? From the time I walk in that gym, I don't know what I had to do. You understand? But I pull up my little tablet and I tape in everything.
Yeah.
You understand? But I know to myself, I know what I had to do.
Mm.
And I was waiting for this time a long time. And I now get the chance to come to the World Championships. And I say I had to do my best. Because I had about 2 or 3 World Championships past me already. Because it's 8 years now on the national team. Right? And this time when I get to go to the World Championships, I say I had to do my best. And so said, so done.
But that 8 years on the national team, was there ever a time where you tell yourself, boy, you wanted to give up or you just keep persisting?
Yeah, about 2 or 3 times. The first time I gave up was them time I used to lime on the streets and things. And I had to make 52 kgs of liming and drinking and smoking. I being real because we boxers, we liming.
Yeah.
You understand? We need hood between Bridget and them. You understand? And then them timing trumpet, who in Cayman Islands now, he was the head coach of the national team, right? And I tell trumpet I dies it because I had to jump to go 52 kgs. I said, nah, trumpet dies it. I done it. I stopped training. I was skipping and I was feeling real born now, boy, because he's smoking and drinking.
Yeah, resting himself
properly. You understand? So I stopped. I tell trumpet dies it. I went in the bathroom, put my clothes, thing, bed. I buy my own skill too. I make sure I have all my gears and everything. You understand? So I get trumpet, my skill. I say, trumpet, that is it. And I go on. And not coming back. But I go on home now. You know, you're enjoying it. You're going to smoke free. You understand? You're going to lime what you want. You're going to sweat it every day. You're going to go where you want now, boy. No training. But after some time, boy. Say, nah, I have to go back to boxing. You got to tell Trump, but I'm not coming back.
Yeah.
But after you might hear a little good news, like Michael doing good all day. You might hear some other boxers on your team going.
Yeah,
boy,
yeah.
Not training, and it could be hot in here. Say, nah, boy. I took go back. And then I went back in the gym and started train by dash. Right by dash, I went back and train. And from there, I really can't remember what happened from there, but I started train. You understand? I started train and made back in national team. And then, no, I lie. I started train, right? And then I had to make back the national team.
Okay. And, because you didn't walk away.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I had to make back the national team. Here we went on, right? In 2017, November, coming on to November, I had to make back the national team. Because remember, I walk off the national team, right? And I trained by dash, but I had to go in the national stadium to give a boxer named Strongy. Let's call him Strongy.
Yeah, I know Strongy.
We had to give him some spine to go at games. And I remember I was working in CIL, in Factory Road, right? And I gave him some spine, and I know when I go in the stadium and I give him spine, I will get Cox to give me training too.
Yeah.
And I will be getting prepared to go in national team. Because remember, I was there already training in the stadium, right? So the Thursday before the national championship was going to start the Friday, November the 17th, and finish the Sunday, right? I go on by dash after the training Thursday. I do some school boxing and some sparring the Thursday night in the stadium. Now go on by dash now. I tell him dash, I said dash. You know, the national championships is Friday. Dash tell me he can't make it because he need to do a surgery on the eye. Right? A real coach, isn't it? Because what Dash in my corner.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't make it, and I didn't make it neither. Why? Because I gonna lose my phone. Right? I lost my phone in the truck. And I had to talk to the coaches. You understand? I have to talk to other people and tell them I'm going and fight.
Yeah.
I go home now. I go on and get a torchlight. I come back looking for my phone, not finding my phone. I said, nah, boy. Can't be doing that, boy. I need that phone. Going back home. The Friday morning, I was supposed to come the way in Marbella. I go on and check Dash, looking for the phone. I ain't find no phone. I check Dash, grandson. The grandson, girlfriend, and all come on. Help me looking for the phone and find the phone. Say, nah, boy, I had to get a phone. You know, on my way, come, go into my brother. I see somebody sitting at the side of me with a nice iPhone. Stupid me now, getting some ideas. They go and snatch him on the phone and run. Right? When I done plan it out already, I sit down, I pay the driver before he stop. As the driver stop, I snatch the phone and run. Headset, everything, run. When I run on the main road. When I run down the main road now, police coming up the main road in traffic. No way to, no side street to run in. Can't do nothing again. The person done reach up already by the walk over there. A driver get to help him, drive up to the police jeep and tell me. No, drive up to the police jeep. And the police siren, and I had no option but to stop running. You understand? And the police come and let me know, well, with the phone, I say, it's in my bag, the boss. You understand? They take out the phone, come in the station. They call the coach, let the coach know, well, I'm in the station. You understand? And I coast in there, I say, way, boy. You understand? I sit down there. I don't make breakfast or kind of thing. Because after the weigh-in, when they go and weigh,
you don't prepare, so, yeah.
You understand? had eaten breakfast right in the station. My hand knocked up on the window with a
handcuff. Yeah.
You understand? I said, hey, boy, that was the day. And then, well, I guess I went in the magistrate court the same day. They gave me a conviction a year, 1 year to do hard labor. You understand? And that is how it was.
You know,
I went in, yes, I went in.
I didn't really know this side of the story, but it's really a positive story. And for you to really come out and talk about it, I hope this could be a motivation for any young person outside there, because after that situation there, you could have gone any direction.
Yeah, sure.
Right? But you see, sometimes in life, we don't choose something. Eh? Something just choose us, and boxing choose you.
Yeah.
You understand? So, I really sit down here and I was kind of captivated by that story. That's why I already stopped here.
Yeah.
And you're brave enough to talk about it. You understand? So, I know we only have about a minute and something before we go on a break, but in a nutshell, what was the experience for you in this World Championship? What it was for you?
Well, the experience for me, I feel like I was now peaking in this sport.
Mm-hmm.
I know everything that I need to know to carry my food I want in my career.
Right.
And with the coaches, Mr. Dopwell and Mr. Reynolds Cox,
mm-hmm.
and the other coaches and the other people who helped and supported me,
mm-hmm.
I go reach really far.
I really proud of you. And what we need to tell you is that sometimes in life, one mistake don't define a person. You understand?
Yeah.
Yeah. I know Dr. Salong there, and I know you're proud of you. You understand?
Because
before, as national coach, he was also instrumental in you. You know, in your journey.
Yeah.
You know, I know we had to take a break right now, but when we come back, Dr. Bell, I want to talk to you concerning the crop of young boxers we had, because when I saw the incident with Michael, I said, boy, we lose Michael, we only have Paul, right? But after this championship here, I saw some not new people, they were always there before, but I see
potential.
So that's what we want to talk about. And we're going to be joined by head coach Reynold Cox. So viewers, we want to take a break. We'll be right back. Remember, this is part two of paying tribute to the young boxers that recently came back from the World Championships. We'll be right back after this short break. Welcome back, viewers. Welcome back to Scoreboard ACT, and I'm talking to young Trinidad Tobago boxer Sean Anthony Joseph, or whatever way you want to call him, and Coach Dopwell. Coach, I sat down just now and I was in a very, you know, kind of emotional state when I heard his story, you know, and I think that what I need to do, I think I have to bring him back another day. You know, because there's another part to this whole life-changing episode for him, because I remember, you know, his house burned down and he lose everything. And
that
I think that is something that young people need to be aware of, you know, to be able to persevere in times of this. But let me get back to you. When we heard about the incident with Michael Alexander, you know, around that time, you really wasn't hearing much about these guys. You were hearing about Nigel and Michael, right? And I sat down and I said, wait, boy, Michael, boy. And so it's only Paul alone to pull to weather the storm. And I didn't see these guys for a little while, because remember, boxing, everything had shut down. But when I saw in the championships abroad with Sean and Donnell and
And blessing.
I said, nah, boy, boxing is in good hands. You know, sometimes when you do see something in the public and you're not aware, you know, you come to your own conclusion, right? Not knowing that all this was happening in the background in spite of the lockdown and the COVID. tell me about what was happening with these guys.
Well, after the lockdown with COVID, again, Mr. Cox was innovative in organizing online training.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we had these guys, we never really let up on them.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, any little apps, they could lose them. So we organized online training. We started the online training. They was involved in that. And then, my own stubborn way, I tell them, I say, look, my gym open, we could train by me. And then within that time, the government say, well, the national teams
could train. Yeah.
Right? So the whole thing organized and everybody start working from Golden Fist Gym, which is in Pitti Valley. And the bonding with the team again, right? How we live and how we react to each other caused these guys to really have trust in the coaches. And we was able to have them on continuing the training, right, Joe? And we were seeing where they elevating. So we never give up and never lapse within the training, within the lockdown. We continue our work because we're seeing that our work bearing fruits.
When you look at the performance, and I think when Mr. Cox come on, I'll ask him the same question too, but you as a coach, when you look at these guys' performance here, what areas in their performance that you think there is still some work to be done to really bring them up to that level where they can be, you know, really be dominant in the sport?
Well, it's all come about awareness, right? These guys, we really wasn't looking for anything spectacular from them in this tournament.
Okay.
We took them to this tournament really to let them get a feel of what's happening outside to know the international world. Because we've been talking to them and tell them, okay, you're Trinidad ready, you're not Caribbean ready.
Yeah.
Or you're Caribbean ready, you're not internationally ready.
Yeah.
Right? So we get the opportunity to take some of them to see what the international level is, but we can't take them to go there to get a beaten. So we put in the work to make sure that when we carry them, they will be at a level that they can perform. And it worked out, it paid off.
So you are satisfied?
Yeah, I really satisfied. And I show Mr. Cox satisfied.
Yeah. Well, I know Mr. Cox have to join us in a while, so let me say thank you for spending this time with us. We want to wish you all the best. And I hope the critics will continue attacking you because, as you said,
motivation.
It's motivating you. Yeah. So the critics out there who feel that the boxing ain't going nowhere and Mr. Dupont is not a good coach, lash him some more.
Keep bringing it.
Yeah, lash him some more. Because remember, we get bronze. It's either silver or gold.
So true.
Right? So we ain't going back down, we're going forward. So, all the best.
Yes, man.
And stay tuned, viewers. The real man, the man who they like to beat. Well, when you see him, you have a body could take licks, eh? He come in on set now. Reynold Cox, the head coach of the Toronto Vigo national team. Welcome back, viewers. Welcome back to Scoreboard on ACTN. Well, joining me on set here now is Mr. Reynold Cox. Mr. Cox is the head coach of the Toronto Vigo national team and the man who instigated the program, the development program, to have these boxers as where they are today. And actually, that's the man who a lot of people who, for their own personal reasons, have attacked him and the program. Now that the program is bearing fruit, you're not hearing anything from these people. But they always say, the old people always saying, when you're doing good, don't expect to hear no set of compliments. Mr. Cox, it's a pleasure. Welcome.
Thanks for having me, George.
Congratulations on your achievement again and the performance of the entire team. They did extremely well. You are one of the person who put this program in place, right, to develop these boxers to where they are today. And you have been criticized a lot, you know, in the past for boxers going abroad and coming back without a medal or whatever it is. But from this last championship here, when you sit now, could you safely say that you are justified that your program is bearing fruits?
Well, you know, the results speak for itself, you know. I think we have to allow results speak, you know, do the talking first, mm-hmm. instead of the old talk and mm-hmm. what I would call sometimes the rum shop talk.
Yeah.
There's too much of that, in, I think, in Trinidad. Our program, our national program, and I can't do the same me alone.
Mm-hmm.
This is a product of Trinidad and Tobago, right? The Ministry of Sports and even the Olympic Committee would have invested in Trinidad and Tobago coaches,
mm-hmm.
and this is the end result of that investment.
Mm-hmm.
I myself, I would have gone to Olympics for that course in Hungary for 3 months in 2007.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I also went 2 years in UTT under the TTBA and did a coaching course. So I am a coach who's a product of Trinidad and Tobago.
Right.
So and the program we have is a product of Trinidad coaches.
Mm-hmm.
Trinidad coaches, we have myself, Mr. Dopwell, Oliver Johnson, we have even Kurt Sennett helping us with our program also, who's a former Olympian, as you well know. We have Mr. Orlando Griffith, another Trinidad, and he's a strength and conditioning coach. We have Anthony McCano, who works with TTOC. I mean, I could just go and give a long list of names of Trinidadians who have come together to develop a Trinidad program for us.
When we seen you and Dopwell in the limelight, there's a whole other set of people.
Yes, there's a team that comes together
mm.
to bring what we're seeing here now.
Mm-hmm.
Because many years ago, 10 years ago, you know, we didn't have boxers at the Olympic Games.
Yeah.
We didn't have boxers winning medals at World Championships. And the government and TTOC and people, they invested in that.
Yeah.
And we are the products of it.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, even all the coaches in Trinidad and Tobago who are boxing coaches, who came into TTBA, we are all a product of that.
Yeah.
So, you know, and it's for us now to come together and show our strength as local coaches.
Because
mm-hmm. before we had Cuban coaches coming here and taking Manzuel to Commonwealth Games and to work with Senate. Senate went to the Olympic Games in 1996. Mm. He went with a Cuban coach.
Yeah.
That's not going to happen again.
Yeah.
Because now Trinidad and coach will take the boxers to the Olympic Games.
You know, Dopwell said something earlier, you know, son. He said it's when a boxer does well, all the coaches benefit. And it's true because take Sean here. That was his coach, right? Then he came to Dopwell, then he come back. Likewise, Nigel and all the rest of the boxers, they were with other coaches, right? So all the coaches supposed to be able to come together, right? And appreciate the product because they were part of the product.
It's a product, the boxer in national team.
Yeah.
It's a product of Trinidad and Tobago coaches.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at it, as a national coach, you know, they always say cocks the TV boxers.
Mm.
But it's my job to select the talented boxers from a national championships, from any gym I see.
So then the national coach of the football team, the TV players then?
Well, apparently so.
You must have a national coach.
Yes, so the national coach, I see the boxers who have the talent.
Yeah.
Right? Even the boxers like Anthony Joseph, at the time I picked him to come in national team, it wasn't for national championships. And he wasn't doing so well, but I saw in him a lot of huge talent. And if you look back in your tapes from 2015,
mm-hmm.
the national championships, Anthony Joseph had probably one of the best performances in national championships, right? And that was due to taking him from his club, World Class,
from
a boxer who has potential. We took him, we brought him onto the national team. And we invested in him. We developed him as best as we could. Myself, Floyd Trumpet, Sadopo. We've been working with the athletes. And this is a product. The more the coaches can bring these boxers to us, is the better and better results we'll get internationally.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody, I think everybody in Trinidad needs to buy in
to that. Yeah. Now, when you look at the performance of the team, right? Donnell and Sean.
And Blessing.
Well, blessings, I'm talking about the result, right? A lot of people and some of the commentators and all were saying, especially with Sean, that they thought Sean had won the fight. Likewise with Donald too, right? As a coach, were you satisfied with the results with those two boxers?
Yeah, I'm definitely, I was, as a coach, I feel, you know, proud that the athletes could go out there and do what we ask them to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the most important thing for a coach, that the athlete, it's not just winning.
Mm-hmm.
People think everything is just about winning.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about winning, it's about the athlete being the best that they could be. And mm-hmm. I think they both put out performances that show that they are competitive. And they, I think we were well pleased.
Mm-hmm.
Even in some instances, we were more pleased with Sean than we were with Paul.
Okay.
In terms of he's showing that his ability to compete.
Yeah.
He's showing his vigor. Mm-hmm. You know, the eagerness to compete.
Mm-hmm.
And his sportsmanship. I think and also a variety of punches you would have seen in the fight. We were able to. And I feel really proud about this, you know. We were able to make him change. Because after the first round, he lost the first round.
Mm.
We were able to make that change with him.
Yeah.
And he was able to respond to the coach's corner, step it up, go to the body. And I think it shows that, yes, the artists are learning something and the program is strong.
Mm. I have a problem with how we tend to show appreciation, because even if you look at this cyclist guy, Nicholas Paul. Nicholas Paul is a world record holder, right? Look at his performance, right? And you could pass anywhere. You see a picture of Nicholas Paul anywhere? No. Our boxers went across there and we did perform, right? But it's like they come back and it's like, right? Now, if everybody had performed badly and we had lost, you would have seen more.
Mm.
Yeah, son. And I think we need to show appreciation to our athletes, you know, a little bit more than what is being done right now. Because to me, I think this is the first time I've seen a group of our boxers has gone out to any tournament and give this kind of performance. You understand? Now, we're talking a bit about the guys, but so far I'm only aware, of one female boxer. What is being done to develop and to get more women involved in the sport?
Well, even through the pandemic, we've not been able to showcase the talent that we presently have right now.
So there are things hiding then?
Yeah, we have a few things in hiding, you know.
Okay, right.
But we definitely want to, we've had programs, of course, that start not probably in 2017 or 18,
mm-hmm.
where we had youth boxers
mm-hmm.
taking part in various competitions.
Mm-hmm.
And those youth boxers, some of those boxers are now becoming elite boxers.
Okay.
So definitely next year, you're going to see a lot more females coming on stream with us.
Mm-hmm.
We even have Faith Ramnath, who's back with us.
Okay, that's
And I think you're going to see them perform really well over the next year or so.
Mm-hmm.
So just about waiting and giving them the chance to perform.
What's out there in the coming distance for our boxers?
Well, as Caribbean champions, the first thing for us is to get back out to the Caribbean Games
mm-hmm.
and defend our crown.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we're very eager to do that. And we're hoping it is held next year,
mm-hmm.
Probably by February.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, our eyes will be turned on to the Commonwealth Games. It's going to be, a challenging tournament for us, even with Nigel winning bronze at the Worlds. It puts a lot of pressure on the coaching staff
mm-hmm.
to ensure that he is as ready as he was for the World Championships. I think there's no going back with us, no preparation now,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, it becomes like a mark card.
Yeah.
When they perform at these
mm-hmm.
Tournaments, mm-hmm. so definitely everybody's going to be looking at Paul and seeing what weakness he have. So we definitely have to improve him. And also for the other boxers, it's a next chance to show their skill and quality at international level at the Commonwealth Games. Because our main focus for the team, of course, is going to be Paris 2024.
Mm. Sean,
yeah.
If I can quickly ask you, what is your main goal to accomplish? What would you like to accomplish, you know, in the sport?
My main goal to accomplish in boxing is to make a good name for myself. Good name for the Trinidad and Tobago boxing team and create some history. Who people could never forget now.
Yeah.
Like how, just like how Nigel make history.
Yeah.
And get a medal, a bronze medal in the World Games. I want, he motivate me and the rest of the team to do better than him.
Yeah.
And to work hard and harder just like him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, when you sit here now, Mr. Cox, and you look at the performance of these guys, and you compare them to what we saw outside here, where do you see us sitting right now? How far are we off from being on a level playing field or even surpassing some of these guys outside?
When I say level playing field, that's the thing. I don't think we're on a level playing field. The reason why we don't have the kind of support to actually have a level playing field.
Okay.
What we have with them is they have been performing exceptionally well.
With what they have?
What they have.
Okay.
So, and we have been very competitive. Right? I mean, it's very difficult to train Nigel Paul by himself with no other pool of super heavyweight boxers.
That's true.
It's difficult to change.
And I think, and I don't think people understand that, you know.
Yeah.
The time, Paul is still a baby in boxing, you know.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you know, they say to us, you know, he's beat the four world championships. But the four world championships is four bouts.
You see, that's the next thing. We look at things that we don't fully understand. Right? When Nigel went to the Olympics, right? It was what? First time.
First time.
Right?
Yeah.
But I see we run out of time. But let me just say, on behalf of myself and ACTN, congratulations to you, Duckwell, and the entire boxing team, right? You have done us proud, right? And these guys who we've seen here now, the sky's the limit.
Of course, yeah,
right? So again, all the best, and viewers, remember at the end of this program, we are going to show you the entire fight with Sean. So you judge for yourself. Again, Mr. Duckwell, Mr. Cox, and Sean, thank you very much for spending this time with us. Remember, there is a repeat of this program tomorrow and also on Saturday. So join us if you miss any part and you will see the entire program. I will be here next week. Have a blessed week ahead. Remember, scoreboard on ACTN. See you next week.
And there is the man boxing for Fair Chance Team 2, Abdul Fawaz Aborode. And here is the opponent. Boxing out of the blue corner, Anthony Joseph of Trinidad and Tobago. So we have five judges scoring these contests here in Belgrade 2021. They come from Korea, Egypt, Zimbabwe, Japan, and Guatemala. The 10-point must system in effect. One boxer must score 10. You can see another one of the innovations that have been implemented here at the World Championships in Belgrade. Red and blue gloves, no longer part of the equipment. Instead, the gloves are white, and the logo, the decals on the gloves, indicate whether the boxer is operating out of the red or blue corner. So, Brendan McGarrigle from Ireland issuing the final instructions, sending the boxers back to their respective corners. And we are underway, bout number 145 of the 2021 IEBA World Boxing Championships is in the 57-kilogram featherweight division. It's between boxers from the Fair Chance 2 team and Trinidad and Tobago. The boxer wearing red is Abdul Fawaz Abarode, just 19 years of age, competing in his first bout of Belgrade 2021, having received a bye in the first preliminary round. That chopping right hand that he landed wasn't too far away. His opponent, the man currently on the back foot wearing blue, is Anthony Joseph, 26 years of age today. Will it be many happy returns as he goes for a double jab right hand but didn't quite find the mark? It's also his first bout of the tournament, having won on a walkover over Niven Chemben of Mauritius in the round of 64. 44 boxers making up the 57-kilogram featherweight bracket. So a fair number of contests in the round of 64. Attempted left hook from Abarode wasn't too far away. It was caught by the right glove of Joseph. Joseph coming forward behind straight punches, but there was no accurate measurement of distance there. His right hand lead was far closer as Abarode, with that right hand planted to his cheek, pulled the trigger then but wasn't in range, trying to draw the man in and walk him onto punches. Good right hand to the body landed by Joseph. He goes downstairs effectively once again. Abarode comes looking for his get back upstairs. And you hear the support for Abarode when he lands anything. Oh, that's a good right hook off the ropes from Joseph. But when Abarode lands anything remotely successful, he's cheered on heartily. And you see the coaches in the corner. The shaven-headed figure is Mike Keane. And that's because the man boxes out of Scotland, part of the Byron Boxing Club up there in Scotland. He's had success at the district level and been on the podium at the youth level as well, the 19-year-old, here representing the Fair Chance 2 team and acquitting himself very well in what is proving to be a competitive opening round. Joseph coming forwards, jolting left, jab landed by the man in blue. It appeared to be more authoritative than that landed by Abarode. Coming forward again, nice counter right hand was the final shot of that exchange, landed by Abarode. Busy work, headshots were blocked that Joseph fired out, but then he did score effectively to the body. Bulldozing his man to the ropes, now is Abarode. There's that chopping right hand he was looking for earlier, found the mark on that occasion, firing back to the body, fighting off the ropes and out of the corner is Joseph, but he'd do well to get himself out of there because he's taking right hands and he's being outworked during the course of that exchange. Then he claims his man, turns the tables and tries to put Abarode close to the ropes, and on the break, my goodness, he helped himself to a muscular right uppercut that snapped the head back of the boxer wearing red. So closing seconds of what has been an action-packed opening round. Very good round of boxing and a sporting touch of gloves exchanged between the boxers before they make their way back to the respective corners. Now remember, AIBA live scoring is in effect, so the coaches will be in receipt of the information, as are we as viewers. But a blistering opening round, and it swept unanimously by Abdul Fawaz Abarode. But make no mistake, Anthony Joseph in the contest, just not doing enough to take the opening round. But he had his moments as well, but not enough of them. Terrific action from both boxers. That's where Joseph was out of distance, and being out of distance with his head shots as he took a counter right hand there, he did make a good adjustment and started to target the body of the man in red, but it was effective aggression applied by the man representing the Fair Chance 2 team. And when he got him in the corner for one portion of the round, he really did enjoy considerable success. So into the second round we go then. In the 2020 Scottish Youth District Championships, Abarode stood on top spot on the podium. The year before in the Youth Championships, he came away with a bronze medal. Anthony Joseph of Trinidad and Tobago took his third national title in 2019. He's been on the global stage before. I first saw him at the global qualification event. There's a nice right hand turned underneath and driven into the belly button. Same shot once again, but Abarode comes right back with that arcing right hand that he likes to throw. Brings the elbow down from on high. Good straight right hand landed by Abarode, but then he was picked off by a right hand left hook. And Abarode really looking for that left hook now, bobbing and weaving in the pocket, gets his man on the ropes again. And you see the chin of Joseph just has a tendency to come up when he's trying to lean away from punches, but the ropes are keeping him within punching range. So that's why it's such a dangerous, disadvantageous position to be on the ropes. Of course, some boxers use it as part of their showmanship, part of their showpersonship. And they get on the ropes and dodge punches in dramatic fashion. Good right hand landed by Joseph. It was a clipping shot, threatened to dislodge the mouthpiece of Abarode, who may have been exhaling to help it on its way, but he managed to keep it in as Joseph working the body once again. Abarode getting back to the space of center ring and looking for that right hand. Joseph peering between high-held gloves, coming forward, measuring his man, but he keeps the attack going with the feet, feinting, but his feints are from beyond punching distance at present. Now adopting a different posture, hands down by the belt line, but both men are out of range. It's going to require a quick-footed burst to get into distance. Joseph trying to do that now. Abarode showing his prowess on the back foot and operating on the perimeter of the boxing ring. There he's looking for that right hand that is such a prominent part of his repertoire once again. Right hand was short of the mark from Joseph. The left hook may have glanced the chin of Abarode. Corkscrew right hand is an effective shot from Joseph, approaching 30 seconds to go in this opening round. Good double jab. The second one did score to the body, as did the follow-up. And terrific work to body then head from Joseph. Brings a right hand around the corner. It was blocked intelligently by the left glove of Abarode. Good work to the body once again. The elbows of Abarode are wide, and it's leaving an avenue for the boxer in blue to drive his punches down. Terrific work. Shots may have been low during that body attack, but look at him dig away with the right hand, body and head from Joseph. A terrific response after conceding the first round unanimously. Abarode may have found himself outworked during the course of that second stanza. How will the judges see it? Mike Keane, the man inside the ring, applying the petroleum jelly and issuing the water. Well, he's taking it only for one judge from Egypt, has Joseph. I think he's a little bit unfortunate there. It was a competitive round once again, but the work rate from Joseph, he wasn't just busier. His work to the body was notable as well, particularly in the closing stages of the round. Abarode electing to go onto the back foot, but in doing so, he was inviting pressure when he found himself on the ropes. But a competitive round taken on a 4-1 split by the boxer representing the Fair Chance team. So this man in a really commanding position now, leading 20 points to 18 on the scorecards of four of the five judges. So into the third and final round then of what has been a very energetic contest so far between two evenly matched opponents. See the effectiveness of the gloves, but again, look at the bodywork of Joseph. It's almost as though Abarode is content to give those shots away to come back with counter right hands like that. Left hook success upstairs for Abarode. Excuse me, for the boxer. But again, if you give away body shots, it's all very well. They're unlikely to knock you out, but if you keep taking those shots around the ribs and around the abs, and particularly in the solar plexus, they can really slow you down the deeper you go into a tournament, the deeper you go into a contest. But Abarode may well feel the effects of those body shots tomorrow. Good left uppercut landed on the inside by the man in red. Spearing left jab and a glancing right cross landed by Joseph. Good defensive work by moving the head from Abarode, but he didn't move his head out of the way of that one. Good right hand to the chin, and then two shots dug into the body. Joseph targeting downstairs to good effect throughout the second and third rounds. There he goes to the body once again. And again with the right hand to the body, as Abarode content to continue to concede those body shots as he goes head hunting. Now that wasn't rewarded in the second round. Look at him backing off now. Has he felt one of those body shots, or is he simply managing the contest, given that he's leading 20 points to 18 for four of the five judges? Another spearing right hand makes its way through to the ribcage of the man in red. Abarode bulldozed to the ropes and takes a beautiful right uppercut on the inside. Same shot once again. Abarode keeping his composure, but takes a left hook as the boxer, as the referee issues the command of break. Good left hook attempted on the inside. Aberode keeping his shape nicely, keeping his composure, dropping his hands now, trying to draw the man in. Joseph accommodates him. Counter right hand attempted by the man in red. Good left jab to the sternum once again. And these are scoring punches. Look at that success. Body then head for Joseph. Aberode protecting his chin. And that's a beautiful counter right hand on the retreat. Aberode goes in search of his payback. The left may have glanced the chin. Right hand was off the mark. Then he takes a right hand from Joseph. Final 30 seconds of this final round. What has been a pulsating contest between these two skillful featherweights. Left-right success for Aberode. Swing and a miss with the uppercut and hook from the man in blue. Joseph trying to target the body again but couldn't quite find the range. The head threatening to come together as the boxers tussle on the inside. Closing seconds of the third and final round. Bustling away to the body once again is Anthony Joseph. Terrific work on the inside. Trying to respond is Aberode. A fantastic contest. That is absolutely brilliant. High fives over in the red corner from the Scottish coaches who are looking after Abdul Fawaz Aberode. I think he's won the contest, but make no mistake, he was in the fight, and I think Joseph won the third round. I think he should have got a greater share of the second round. But given the way it has been scored, with Aberode leading four cards, 20 points to 18 after two completed rounds, well, I don't think Joseph was able to produce the massive round that he needed to turn things around. I think he's really unfortunate with those second round scores. Let's get the announcement. And I think, given the scorecards, Aberode will be progressing.
Ladies and gentlemen, in the bout number 145 in the ring A, the winner of points by split decision is the boxer out of the red.
And there's confirmation. Anthony Joseph bitterly disappointed. Ecstasy at the announcement. Etched on the face of Abdul Fawaz Aberode. That is how he's done it. A 4-1 split, four cards returned of 28 points to 29. And the Zimbabwean judge scoring every round for this man, which I do find rather surprising. Now, I'm not looking to stir a hornet's nest here, but there is a bout review procedure available. Each team gets three bout reviews. They have to follow a very strict protocol within limited time parameters. And I wonder whether the Trinidad and Tobago team will implement the bout review procedure regarding the scoring of that second round, because work such as that appear to go unrewarded from Anthony Joseph. Make no mistake, it was a terrific contest, a very close one. But a 4-1 split against the man in blue in the second round. I'm not...
Hey everyone, my name is Nigel Paul, Olympian, super heavyweight boxer for Trinidad and Tobago, and this is The Face of Boxing.
My name is Nigel Paul from Enterprise Lanonville. And this is my story.
Well done, Nigel. Well done, mate. You put your name down in the history books, and rightly so. You deserve to be there. You really do. Inspiring the rest of the team, leading from the front. You've had your setbacks. You've had a rough journey. And I think it only shows the strength of character and resolve for you to come back and put in that performance and walk away with a medal, mate. Thoroughly deserved that. Can't wait to catch up with you when you're back.
Check this, Satan can't take me in your checklist. Man, I worry a long time. Miss Lou them like Moses' apprentice. When we roll out for Jesus Christ and sold out, you know if we question lifestyle clean and there is no doubt. Anointing build up in a me. Word of God shut.
I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate Nigel Paul on his recent success at IBA's Men's World Championships in Serbia, where he got bronze. He created history for himself and for the country, being the first boxer, male or female, to medal at a World Championships. I just want to tell him, great job, well done, and keep going forward.
We no leave soldiers behind. We no leave people fi die. Messenger nation, messenger nation. We no leave soldiers behind. We no leave people fi die. Lyrically, I'm not ill, I'm healthy. Blessings are grow on me tree, do not help me. It's not about me, it's not about you. Simmer down yourself like idols do. Clean heart, I do it. Humility, I do it. Not everything you have, you have a response to it. Lord, disciples, we are make. And a Jesus, are harder with steps. So then, when we roll out for Jesus Christ and sold out, you know if we question lifestyle clean and there is no.
I would like to congratulate Nigel Paul on winning the bronze medal at IBA World Championships Boxing. He did exceptionally well. He made history for Trinidad and Tobago and history for himself. He made the country proud, the coaches and his fellow members. And I would just like to say I appreciate getting to see you elevate, develop to this stage. As a member of the team as well, I appreciate you, bro. Mentor, big brother, all the way. Congratulations, bro.
No matter how evil I come against me, boy, darkness can conquer the light in a way them can end we. Standing with the lion, destined unto Zion. Fearless like a Spartan. Remember one chase a thousand. Me never hear killer killing creator. Me never hear the righteous bout of failure. Christ give me the power to turn a real dominator. So me na-
Hey, what's up? This is James Saunders, and I just want to send lots of love out to my very good friend Nigel Paul. Nigel, this is what a proud face looks like, and you're responsible for that. Thank you for making us proud. Thank you for wearing the badge and representing the red, white, and black with pride and making us all very proud. All right, good luck in the rest of your endeavors, and I look forward to seeing even more success for you in the future. Catch you later.
Aldemon family member. Better be careful of the things where you touch. More than your dreams could get crushed. You ever hear about God's wrath? Well, when the war started, down to the wire. In the face of evil, real soldiers, we don't surrender. Down to the wire. Just like David, we standing up bold, cause Jah are we defender. Down to the wire. In a Goliath face, we don't ramp and play. Down to the wire. Every evil get crushed when the righteous kneel and pray. True soldiers marching out. No matter who bout of corruption, we standing out. The wicked will try, but we nah no doubt that to the most high blessed get the victory shout. Never bow, never bend. Ain't no way how, ain't no time when. You go see the righteous get forsaken.
Hi boxing fans, it's your boy Michael Alexander. I just want to take a few seconds of your time today to give a special congratulations to Nigel Paul for bringing back hardware for Trinidad and Tobago. I'd like to give a special thanks to the coaches as well, Mr. Cox, Mr. Dapwell, for pushing Nigel Paul to extreme limits to bring back hardware for Trinidad and Tobago. Nigel, this is just the start, eh? Remember, I tell you, this is the start. I mean, this is the start for betterment. And we're going for gold, always.
Take us higher. We stand with the consuming fire. The weapons we use is a sword and prayer. We taking this tongue to the wire. In the face of evil, real soldiers, we don't surrender. Come to the wire. Just like David, we standing up whole, cause Jah are we defender. Come to the wire. In a Goliath face, we don't ramp and play. Come to the wire. Every evil get crushed when the righteous kneel and pray.
It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I've got some blessings that I don't deserve. I've got some scars, but that's how you learn.
What gets you?
It's nothing short of a miracle.
And he gets it, Nigel Paul, and the coaching staff are loving that because he's won that final round 10-9 across the board. And Paul gets it. Another 3-2 split. 3-3-2 split.
A million little miracles.
For me, it
was a miracle.
The work that was done, the preparation, the plan that was set out from the coaches and the coaching staff, was really and truly painful. Boxing is a study for the coaches and for the athletes to go there and execute and perform.
You held me steady so I wouldn't give up. You opened doors that nobody.
Hey Nigel, I want to say congrats on a job well done at the Ibo World Championships, winning the bronze medal and creating history for Trinidad and Tobago.
Yeah, Nigel, as coaches, we want to congratulate you again on your medal. We give thanks for the showing of the coaches, and we hope that they continue in the leg and winning more medals for Trinidad and Tobago. Big up.
Yeah, well done, Nigel.
I hope I never get over what you've done.
Congratulations, Nigel Paul, on your bronze medal at the 2021 World Games.
The first of the white making is you alone, brother.
Nigel Paul, congratulations for getting that bronze medal for Trinidad and for making history for Trinidad. In Jesus' name, we continue to work harder. Trinidad.
It's not coincidence and it's not luck. I know it comes from above. I've got miracles on miracles. A million miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. Miracles on miracles. A million little miracles. Yeah. Miracles on miracles. Your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. I can't even count them all.